Good afternoon. Welcome to session six of European Entrepreneurship and Innovation at Stanford Engineering. Today, we're very pleased to feature our first Latvian startup. We've been doing this program for 7 years here at Stanford, and it's taken us far too long to get to Latvia. And we're also presenting our second Slovakian company today. So our speakers are Matej Fatačnik, co-founder of The Spot in Bratislava, and Miko Jarvenpa, Chief Operating Officer of Infogram, which is based in Riga and also has offices here in Silicon Valley. Just to give you a quick overview of Infogram is a really interesting infographics company. I would, in my opinion, they're the leader in basically online infographics. They developed themselves around a base of enterprise customers initially in Riga. And they're a very interesting company, which is also venture-backed, which Miko is going to talk about. The Spot is based in Bratislava. It's a very interesting up-and-coming accelerator, focusing primarily on ICT, but also on moving into some other interesting areas, which Matej may or may not tell us about, because some of it's under wraps at this point. But Bratislava is definitely an up-and-coming startup ecosystem in the Central Eastern European region. So now on to our speakers. Matej has flown all the way in from Bratislava to give this talk. He spent a lot of time in the United States, so he knows the US and Silicon Valley quite well. So he's in an excellent position to tell us, draw some of the differences between what's happening in Slovakia and the Valley. But really, you're the first speaker who's going to give us an overview of the startup ecosystem and entrepreneurship across Slovakia. Thank you for coming all the way from Bratislava. Let's give Matej a hand.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Great.
There you go.
Thank you. So good evening. My name is Matthew, and I'm very thrilled to be here. Well, a couple of years ago, when I was still here with this, in an accelerator with a small startup, I attended this classes, I think 4 years ago. My dream was to come here one day and to present. So it's a small dream come true for me. But today, what I want to say or want to present is the Slovak startup ecosystem, give you an idea of a country that is rather small in the European measures compared to, I wanted to say that we are 5.5 million citizens, so we're roughly the size of Finland in terms of citizens. The GDP of Slovakia is 94 billion for last year, and the revenue for IBM is 99 billion for last year in the States. So, you know, we're not a big country, but we're the biggest and greatest in per capita is we're the largest car manufacturers in the world. We have Kia, we have Volkswagen, we have Porsche, we have Hyundai, I believe, and Citroën, all manufacturers in Slovakia, they are building their cars. And that is something that the last 15 years, 20 years, have been a great influence on how Slovakia's economy is looking and is being pushed forward. And also, that brings a challenge to Slovakia, because right now, it's mainly, you know, building cars, just screwing the knots together and creating the cars, not creating a knowledge economy. So I would like to talk today a little bit about how changing the economy from a manufacturing country to a country with a substantial knowledge economy part inside of it as well. This is the lovely Bratislava, the capital of Slovakia. It's a city of 500,000 citizens, so it's small, but it has a good location. It's very close to Vienna. Those are actually the two closest capitals in the world. It's only 40 miles from each other, so it has a very good connection there. But getting to how the ecosystem in Slovakia looks like and what we have been building in the ecosystem for the last couple of years, we started in the year 2012 creating an NGO called The Spot. And that was it was basically the first creative space for startups in Slovakia that had, or right now has, 700 square meters of office space, provided and still provides a lot of educational stuff for engineers, for business people, for salespeople, marketing people, fundraising support, and also did a lot of mentorship with mentors from the region, not only from Slovakia, but also from the other countries that flew in or are supporting the startups. This has been done only thanks to sponsors and with corporate sponsors, basically. It has been zero government money put into the Spot in the past 2 to 3 years. So this is a a little bit different approach in, compared to all the other countries or most of the countries in Europe, where the startup ecosystem is also being heavily supported by the government. We see some early changes and some early shifts in that, and we'll talk about it a little bit later. And last year, we saw that at last the ecosystem is ready to have a incubator or accelerator being created in Slovakia. So we created something that we named the Booster. And we thought of creating not only an accelerator, but also like a three-step program, where the first one we called Idea Market, and it was taking the people from the corporates and from schools, putting it together with ideas and idea makers, those are successful entrepreneurs, and creating new companies, then running them through an incubator program, and then running them through an accelerator program. So it was a three-step program. And for the last one, we have a great partner, or we created a consortium with a couple of other accelerators in the region, with Wise Guys from Estonia, with Startup Yard from Czech Republic, with Digital Factory from Hungary, and OCC from Lithuania. And we created a project called Seed Tech, and that is a project that is supported by the European Commission. And thanks to that, we're able to provide financing for startups in the region with starting with 30K of financing for every single startup, and then putting additional 30 to 250K of additional financing for the best ones there. The value proposition of the CTEG is that we have not only 450 mentors in those five countries together that are trying to support the startups, but the spot what makes us different with the approach and has been rather successful, and we'll talk about it a little bit later, is having entrepreneurs in residence and experts in residence on site, on call for the startups. So we have roughly 8 to 10 people sitting in the spot every single day. We're able 24/7 to support the startups in technology and marketing, sales, distribution, and product. And it's been a great success in terms of pushing the startups forward a little bit more than only having a mentor coming for an hour or two into the space and giving a talk to those guys. The focus for the whole Seed Tech is data, basically anything that right now is cool and modern in the space of IT and online startups. But what we have in Slovakia, and I believe that is a good selection, is we're doing B2B SaaS security and a little bit of gaming and fintech. Because we believe that from a small country like Slovakia, it is rather easier to create a B2B startup than a B2C startup, depending on the size of the market and the ease of creating a business-to-business company. Just to give you an idea how the spot looks like and what's the life at the spot, there are a couple of pictures. There's a lot of events there happening. We tend to do 3 to 4 events per week in terms of getting the ecosystem excited and engaged. Either those are networking events or then educational talks that we give there. Those are numbers from the last 3 years of running the booster or the spot and then the spot booster. It's we've worked with 25 companies and startups that were in the spot. 56% of those received some funding altogether, 1.5 million of euros. We altogether support 150 startups, and 8 of those attended international accelerators like Vira or Techstars and these other ones. From event kind of a point of view, it's 6,500 attendees for different events, and we're very happy that this is basically in a country of 5.5 million citizens and a capital of 500,000, that's quite a lot of people that went through the doors that was excited about startups and entrepreneurship. And we created altogether 420 events. In terms of the team, we have members, they're excited startupers and entrepreneurs. It's 400 of those. Altogether, 115 years of business experience, and so on. So it's a strong team sitting right there, trying to work with the ecosystem. And last year, we created something that we call the Academy. It is an online system where we handpicked the best classes, the best courses online that can be done from Stanford, from MIT, from different places. Put them together, and we created. Also our own 80 hours of video for educational purposes that any Slovak or anybody that goes for the spot at SK can click and can leverage. And that is a strong thing. And also, that's not here on the slide, Yes, we're running the Stanford Lean Launchpad educational program. We had two successful runs of that in terms of making students or teaching students and young entrepreneurs how to create a startup in a very structured way and in a way that Steve Blank has created as a methodology, and we adopted that in Central Europe. A little background for me, and then I promise I'm going to go for the good parts of the ecosystem. I started with founding the first company. You probably don't know a lot of the brands here, but that's okay. The first company I started was Innovasys when I was 18 on university. Scaled that to 15 employees, and we're selling software to 8 European countries by the age of 21. Then moved to the Valley with a company called Nice Reply, or started Nice Reply. Then also with a company called Quality Unit, where I was doing mainly biz development or biz dev. In terms of NGOs, we created startup camps, and that's a very exciting thing I would like to explain or introduce you to. That was actually the first networking event in Slovakia for startup entrepreneurs. And it is, we then expanded from Bratislava to several Slovak cities and also to Prague, the capital of Czech Republic, where these events are still held today. Then, obviously, the spot. And I was lucky enough that I was nominated the Forbes 30 Under 30 last year in Slovakia and won a startup award in Slovakia for Nice Reply. Plus, I helped to bring startup weekends to the region and organize Pioneers Festivals mentoring sessions for the top 50 startups from Slovakia and supporting them in business development. Talking about the ecosystem Slovakia, now that I proved myself that hopefully I can talk about this a little bit, is I divided it to rare ingredients and abundant ingredients of what's there in Slovakia. Let's start with the rare one. It's the business talent. We're really lacking business talent there. It's the problem that if you're a good entrepreneur or a good business student, you probably have not went to a Slovak school. And if you have went to a good Slovak school, then you needed to have experience from abroad. And if you have those two qualities, then you probably are not back in Slovakia, but you're in London, you're in Berlin, you're in the Valley or somewhere else doing your startup, you're doing your business, and not sitting back in Slovakia where it's a little bit harder. So that's the first thing that I think is really, really lacking is the number of qualified students or number of qualified young entrepreneurs. We're trying to change that with introducing the Lean Launchpad and introducing more of the classes, but it's been a struggle. Then the next problem is serial entrepreneurship. We don't have enough serial entrepreneurs, or if I think of it, I can't really think of any serial entrepreneurs that have exited their company and have been starting another company, another startup, with all the knowledge and with all the experience that they brought with the successful exit of the first one. Usually, since Central Europe is a region where there's not a lot of exits, those entrepreneurs stay a long time with the company. It can be very successful, it can be very good, but they stay at the one and they don't create another ones. In terms of mediocre support, we're talking about government support. It has been lacking in the past several years, but now Slovakia has really been committed to support the startup ecosystem. I'm very excited to see what's actually going to come out of the support and what are going to be the concrete steps of supporting the ecosystem. A good thing is that our universities are providing high-quality engineers. Being part of the Eastern Europe, and historically we have very good mathematics and physics schools and universities, and equated to very good computer science classes as well. Problem is that there's not a lot of these engineers, and the ones that are there are usually sucked up by Dell, IBM, Lenovo, Amazon, all the other companies, the big corporates that came to Slovakia to create their development R&D centers. So getting a good engineer in Slovakia for a startup has, you know, not a lot of equity, not a lot of capital is providing to be a challenge. But on the other hand, what's abundant in Slovakia, and this is very fresh, this is basically from last year, is the access to venture capital. And this might be very surprising to you that in Central Europe there's a lot of capital there. But thanks to European Commission and to the Jeremy program and to us getting the money from the European Commission as well, or from the VC funds around us, there's a lot of money in the region. I think there's more money than startups that can actually leverage that money in the place. It's not as bad as in Hungary. I don't know if you know the story, but in Hungary there's a way too much money to the amount of the size of the startup ecosystem. But still, also in Slovakia, it is fairly easy today to fundraise and to get your first angel or seed size round from local players. And that last point is a little bit of a joke. Slovakia is a 5.5 million country. That means that it's too small to really seriously think of that as your final market for building a company. And that's a good thing. So most of the Slovaks are thinking globally, or we're helping them to think globally in terms of looking at Germany, looking at the States as their final market where they want to launch their businesses. The problem is that, is there a problem? Yeah, so compared to countries like Czech Republic, it's 10 million. It's 10 million citizens, the economy is 4 times the size of Slovakia. They have the problem that a lot of the very good talented entrepreneurs are staying in Czech Republic and building the companies there and not going global. So for us, this is a good thing that we have a too small market to actually make sense for a lot of the businesses. I have four success stories or four companies that I would like to show you here. The first one is ESET. You probably know these guys. It's a cybersecurity antivirus company with more than 100 million customers worldwide. They have their offices in San Diego and in Bratislava with more than 1,000 employees. And we have Sygic. ESET is like it's the poster child for Slovakia for technology companies, but you have been on the market for 10 to 12 years, so still it's been way too long for them, but still we're using them as a success story. Then we have Sygic, and that's a mobile navigation. Probably know those guys, 55 million customers. We have a wonderful, I think it's number 6 of the Facebook partners in the world for gaming, Pixel Federation, and these guys are really rocking it. They have more than 200 employees and 25 million users or gamers in their network. And also, you know, talking about not enough exits in the region, there's one that's been created, and that's MDOT. And that was a mobile web creator that has been exited in under 12 months, if I'm correct. And I'm happy that the Slovak founder is sitting right there, Pavel, and if you want, or the Czech one, it was a Czechoslovak startup with a wonderful Slovak wife. And you can talk to them later on if you want to see how a company from the region actually looks like and they're exiting. Or, yeah, thank you, Pavel. Thank you. Yeah. But something really exciting, talking about the history of Slovakia or the country where we built cars. I know that you have your Elon Musk and you have your electric cars, that's nice and dandy, but we have flying cars. And I think this is way cooler. And this is not only a visualization, this is a real car, a real prototype, a real thing that actually really flies. There's a beautiful video on aeromobile.com. And those some of the best and brightest entrepreneurs from Slovakia and angel investors are putting money into this, and I think that this has created a lot of excitement in Silicon Valley as well, and they are on a very good path to be the next poster child from Slovakia and building a really really exciting company. So Aeromobile is something. If you have a spare few minutes, go to their website, look at the video. You're gonna really want to buy that kind of stuff. Talking about the Spot Booster and what we created and what are the early successes, I would like to say that from the last year, we were trying a test run or dry run of the accelerator. Not in a structured way, it was basically cherry picking companies and working with them in a way that we wanted to validate if our approach to supporting startups has made any sense and is actually bringing support. And we saw from 3 startups we were working with, 2 managed to get $500,000 seed investment, thanks or also because of working with us from regional players, and as Data Molino and Edoku. And last week we actually selected the next batch, and it's 6 startups. Again, we want to have small batches, not a lot of companies, a small batch, so we can do really hands-on work. Those are the 6 down there. So hopefully in a couple of years, when I come back, we'll see more success stories from these guys as well. I was talking about the support of the government. And this is a great thing for us that the president, Andrej Kiska, the select president, came here to Stanford in November or October last year and met with the Stanford president, Joanna L. Hennessy, and discussed the way how Slovakia can be part of the innovation ecosystem and all of that. And it created a lot of good positive energy in Slovakia this trip because it took a lot of angel investors and startups entrepreneurs here and to New York and try to create a bridge between those two countries. So we're excited to see what actually gonna happen or what is actually going to come out of the trip or of the support. But this is a very good sign. To give you an overview of the ecosystem, I will not go into details for the specific companies, but as I mentioned, there's a lot of venture capital. Some of it is private. A lot of it is supported by the governments or by the European Commission. In terms of community, in the last 2 years, we saw a lot of new co-working spaces being opened up, a lot of new networking events that sprung up in the region. In terms of universities, there are 2 to 3 notable ones that are creating good engineers, and that's STU and the University of Comenius that is creating the engineers. In terms of business, I think the Economic University is the best one in Slovakia for that kind of purpose, but still there's a lot of steps that need to be done in order to really create good entrepreneurs, ready people for being entrepreneurs. And the government, SBA, is right now creating a lot of, the Slovak Business Agency, a lot of efforts in pushing the agenda of the government forwards. Last slide with boring company logos. Corporates are getting very excited. The banking industry, the IT industry, and the telco industry are the three most important ones right now in terms of working with the ecosystem. So banking for fintech, telco, and the IT companies are right now the ones that are pushing forward and try to work with the startups, trying to create partnership models with startups. We have a wonderful association. It's the Slovak Association for Internet Economy, SAPIA, in the translation, trying to support the ecosystem in terms of working with the government, talking to them, and explaining to them what actually is important, is not important in the government changes of the laws. Then we have incubators, accelerators. As I mentioned, it's us, it's the booster. And then two new ones, it's Rubik's Lab. They just opened their first round last week. So very exciting to see that. And Brainhouse, and that's an incubator for techies. And also good thing is that major startups in the region are supporting the ecosystem. And in terms of bringing in slowly knowledge of how the international ecosystem works like, how sales on a global scale needs to be done, how marketing really works, online marketing, and this kind of stuff. So it's good that these guys are giving back to the ecosystem, even though they're not exited or big enough, they're also supporting them. And getting it relevant to the Silicon Valley or thinking of how Slovakia could be connected to the Valley, I have four points or four parts for that. The first one is we would love to get more mentors, experts, US entrepreneurs, teachers flying in to Slovakia and discussing and talking about the proper way of building the companies and scaling them for the Slovak entrepreneurs, for them to really get more knowledge of building the global businesses. Then it will be great for Slovak startups to get a market access or discovery, having somebody here or getting a structured program of pushing Slovaks or Slovak companies to the Valley for them to have the experience, and that really helps a lot. Just brainstorming, creating a Slovak house for that fosters relationships and acts as a bridge would be a great thing. Then access to later stage capital. Even though seed stage and angel is available in Slovakia, later stage makes a lot of sense to be taken from the Valley or from London, and fostering those relationships would make a lot of sense. And then the last thing is also, as in the region, Central and Eastern Europe, you have privately owned companies like Swarovski, you have big corporations like Asseco, you have banks that are have headquarters right in Slovakia. It makes sense for them to have scouts here in the Valley to look for innovation, to look for new things that they can implement in their product portfolio and also foster and boost their innovation. With this thought, I would like to conclude the talk that I right now have, and I would like to open the floor for discussion, if I'm correct. Thank you.
Questions?
Yes, anyway. To follow up your last point there mm-hmm. about scouting innovation, it's one thing for the big companies to come here, mm-hmm. but are they also entering your booster? Because that's what is happening in the Valley now. Big companies are going into the accelerators to scout for smaller companies that they could work with. Are you seeing large companies?
Yeah, that's a very good point. Yeah. As I mentioned prior to, we have been supporting only by corporates for the first 2 years of running the spot, and it was a logical step also for the booster for the corporates to be involved and deeply involved in the accelerator. So for the companies that are right now in the batch, it's really easy to access a huge bank in Slovakia. It's easy really access to access to biggest IT software solution provider in this kind of folks, because they have been part of the Spot family for a long time. Now it's easy for them to work with us.
But is Accelerator providing services specifically for the large companies?
We're seeing this trend, and the corporates are trying to or asking for this kind of services and trying to find the right way how to work with them, how to make a relationship that is long lasting. But yes, we're trying to work with ideation workshops, innovation workshops, networking events for corporates and startups and this kind of stuff to really start a discussion of how to do a structured relationship.
Okay. Yes, Barbara.
Thank you for being here, first off. One thing, I did want to mention that the Flying Aeromobile, not it, but one of its inventors will be at South by Southwest. So if anybody's going there, they'll have a chance to hear him talk about it. I wanted to mention briefly and ask your opinion about some of the companies that are moving back within the NATO protectorate and are moving to Košice, for example. Mm-hmm. An example here would be GlobalLogic. So are you finding that's becoming a hub? Maybe you could talk a little bit about that.
Sure. That's a very good point. Slovakia is not only Bratislava, as we from Bratislava would like to see it, but also we have a lot of different cities. And the second biggest one is Košice. And we see a lot of IT companies there. We see Deutsche Telekom having a huge position there. We see NES, we see Dell having their offices there. And also, a lot of small, there is a good engineering university there, so good talent is coming from that region. The problem there is that it's a little bit hard in terms of connections. There's like 4 connecting flights per day, that's it, and you have a railway that takes forever to go anywhere to the Western Europe, so it's still not there in terms of connectivity, but we saw the first co-working space opened there last year in Košice. We see university incubators sprouting up in Košice. So I think that would be a good place to look at for further development down the road.
And let me just recognize Barbara Pivnitska, Honorary Consul for the Slovakian Republic, and Richard Pivnitska, Honorary Consul for the Czech Republic. Thank you for coming. Well, let me ask last question. So, this focus on enterprise, mm-hmm. B2B, is unusual to find in
Why?
Europe. Well, from an accelerator co-working space, I mean, typically there's a relatively large divide between the corporate sector in Europe and the startup sector. You don't see European corporates really heavily engaged in supporting startups, unlike Google, Facebook, Microsoft, some of the major US companies, IT companies. What has been the response from the corporate sector in Central Eastern Europe around entrepreneurship? What do you see in terms of their own interests in bringing innovation into their companies, and how are they responding to the entrepreneurship challenge?
So since they have been mostly involved for the last 2 to 3 years, some of them, in working with the startup ecosystem, they're slowly getting it. They're understanding what it means to run a startup that's completely different than the business unit in their company. And it has different logic, different pace, different structure, different atmosphere, and they're trying to understand how they can implement and use this, super speed for them to create more innovation in their corporate spaces. So we see CEOs of big companies coming to the spot on a weekly basis for an hour or two, talking to the entrepreneurs and trying to understand how they can kickstart back their innovation engine, basically.
Let's see, I have another question. Last night at dinner, mm-hmm. we were talking about your experience in introducing Lean Launchpad mm-hmm. into Slovakia.
Yeah.
What has been the reaction of the attendees, the students, the companies going through this when you tell them that they have to actually go out into the marketplace yeah. and talk to real customers, real users, mm-hmm. and they can't stay in the lecture hall
exactly.
and actually yeah. just write, yeah. write notes? How does that go over in Slovakia?
That's a great question. So Lean Launchpad is a formalized 8 to 12 week program for young entrepreneurs who want to learn how to build businesses. And we've been trying to implement this in Slovakia. And usually the Slovak students are, and we've been schooled for this for the last 20 years, sitting in your classroom just writing notes, never actually standing and giving a talk, and not, you know, doing public speaking is something that is not very common for Slovaks. So for them to actually go out and to talk to customers, what is the most single important ingredient of building a good company, understanding your customers, is a real challenge for them. So what we usually have to do, we need to basically babysit them along the way for the first couple of weeks and walking with them outside and applauding to those guys. They're getting actually kicked out of the companies in terms of they're too pushy, but that's exactly what we're trying to teach them. And asking and getting answers is the really important part for the learning.
Because asking students to go up and talk to complete strangers is considered
absolutely rude
and an invasion of privacy.
Exactly.
You would never consider doing that.
No
it would
way.
Be considered radical.
Yeah.
Okay. Very different from here. And so this is one of the things you need to consider if you're thinking of bringing Lean Launchpad techniques developed here in the Valley, at Berkeley, other places around the United States to Europe, is that this culture of engaging with complete strangers is quite different in many countries outside the U.S. So, Mate, thank you very much.
Thank
we're going
much.
To come back to you. We're going to bring you back up at the end along with Miko for a joint Q&A. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So our next speaker is Miko Jarvenpa. Can I just
yes.
borrow this for a sec? I need to
I'd
advance
like to take your
you
hand as well.
Along. The founder, Uldis Leitertz, who is based in Riga, unfortunately could not make it for the session because of conflicting travel engagements, obligations in Asia. We're very delighted to have Miko here, who is based here as the chief operating officer. Who's going to tell us about both the story of Infogram, but also a little bit about the Latvian startup ecosystem.
Yes.
So, thank you,
Miko. Thank you, Bertin. Okay, thanks, everyone. It's great to be here. I will be talking about, like Bertin said, a little bit about Infogram. I'll tell you the story of the company, and I'll walk you through the product quickly. I'll tell you a little bit about Latvia, and I will also make some hopefully informed observations about the Latvian startup and tech ecosystem. And as a caveat, first of all, I'm not from Latvia. I'm from Finland, as maybe the keenest have noticed from the abundance of umlauts in my name. And even though Finland is very close to Latvia and it's kind of in that general direction, that's actually not the connection why I'm there. It's too often, it's too easy to assume that that's why they're, you know, it must be related. You know, it's a bit like you say, I'm from Finland, and then somebody goes, oh, I've been to Denmark once. It's like, not even close. It's, you know, if you're from the US, it's like saying, oh, I went to Guatemala once. You know, it's not, it's in that general direction, but it's the same degree of relevance. I used to work for Google for a long time. I started my career actually fresh out of college with Google, and I stayed there for about 5 years. Working first with the product ops team and then with the product marketing team. And there had the opportunity of working with emerging markets in Europe and opening those markets. My connection with Infogram comes from Hack Forward, who was an early stage venture capital company based out of Hamburg and invested in multiple companies across Europe. And Infogram was one of our investments. So I've been in one shape or form involved since day one with them. Infogram is a data visualization tool online that we make available as a software as a service product. You can easily start to use the product by simply going to Infogram, which is infogr.am, and registering for free, and you will get most of the power of the product at your fingertips. If you're like me, you will first get access to your library of infographics, charts, visualizations that you have created. We also make it very easy for you to get started with the pre-designed themes. Some of them are here labeled Pro, which means those are available for people who pay $15 a month as the subscription. But there's lots of free themes templates available for everybody as well. Behind the charts is a very familiar spreadsheet type interface that lets you manually input data or copy-paste data from spreadsheets. But it also includes a live data connection over here. So from load data, you'd be able to connect a live JSON feed or a published Google spreadsheet, for instance, which really changes the nature of infographics quite a bit, because infographics too often have been just static visualizations, pretty large, also non-responsive images that often get pretty unlegible on mobile screens and also don't update when the data changes. But we're changing both of these things. We have about 30 different chart types that you can pick from in the library. A lot of them, most of them support live data behind them, and all are interactive when you embed or share them. And when you're done, you are able to publish an infographic publicly. So you get a link on the web, which you can share socially, or you get various embed codes as a responsive or fixed version, for instance. Or if you're a pro user, you can also share the infographic privately with a password, for instance. So the idea for Infogram was born in the newsroom. The two founders, Uldis and Raimonds, were in the receiving end of requests for data visualizations from journalists at their job, and started thinking that there must be an easier way to do this. So they initially wanted to create a product that was simple enough for journalists to use. And that's how I pitched it at the Graduate School of Journalism in Berkeley 2 weeks ago, and that didn't go down very well. But the newsroom was the starting point. And no matter how you look at the newsroom, how you look at the publishing industry, whether you look at the print advertising revenues or industry employment for the last couple of decades, there's this steady downward trend. But we think there is a content type out there that is engaging for people, engaging enough for people to get excited about. And everybody who's been on the internet in the last couple of years knows that that content type is, of course, funny cats. There's totally no denying the staying power and engagement of funny cats that people have. And actually, if you look at the Google search trend for funny cats over here in the red line, you see that it indeed does have some serious staying power over the last couple of years. But there's a challenger in the blue corner, and that is the search demand for infographics. And as you can tell, maybe through this slightly awkward metaphor, but as you can tell, there is really a demand for infographics that has not waned. There was talk about us reaching peak data visualization at some point, but we live in such a data-saturated world that the demand for the ability to visualize, but also to consume data in a visualized format is only growing. And if we look at some of the numbers behind Infogram, the company has been around for 3 years. We'll have a birthday in 2 days. We have 1.6 million registered users who've created, I think it's close to 3 million infographics by now. So if we assume that 4 minutes are spent by a single user on the product when they come in, some just kick the tires, some spend hours, that already gives us about 12 years of humanity's time spent on Infogram creating visualizations. And that's just the longer end of the lever. The that's the consumption side. Our infographics are seen by tens of millions of people per month, is of course even bigger. We have a team of around 40 people. Most of them are in Riga, in Latvia. I'm based over here in San Francisco. I'm based here and on planes, it feels, because I definitely go there every month. We have raised around $2 million total from Europe-based investors. HackForward was the first investor in Infogram, and later it was joined by, in a seed round, by Point9 Capital and Connect Ventures from Germany and UK, respectively. Our key customers come from media and publishing, but also content marketing, to separate needs but similar use cases. We are seeing growing use in an internal enterprise use case, where you can imagine that people, where people have traditionally shared PowerPoint slides as attachments, for instance. The consumerization of enterprise means that it is often much more natural to just share links to visualizations, for instance, instead of adding attachments in an email. And education is a big market for us as well. We both have we have demand from students, say from senior high to from college, and then from teachers to from as young as I think 8 or 10 year olds are using Infogram. Some of the logos, some of our users include Euronews, University of Cambridge, El Confidencial. And I'll now switch gears and talk about Latvia a little bit. I'll hopefully be able to answer your questions about it. Like I said, I have an informed outsider's view of the situation there, which I hope will provide a few interesting nuggets. But if you're going to ask me some specific questions, like the year Latvia joined the NATO, I may not be able to. Oh, that one I know actually. It's 1999. But nonetheless, Latvia and Riga in numbers. Latvia is a country of about 2 million people, a bit less. In terms of population, it is just a tiny bit bigger than the Nashville, Tennessee metro area, although the Nashville, Tennessee metro area is much bigger in terms of GDP. The purchasing power parity adjusted GDP per capita is around 52nd in the world. It's about half of the comparable in the US. And the comparisons can get pretty dramatical when you look at San Francisco and Riga. The rent is really almost 90% cheaper there. And the apartments are gorgeous. And there's, you know, so much up for grabs. I mean, really, go over there in the summer and take a look around. I highly recommend that. Total cost of living is considerably lower as well, as is, of course, purchasing power. But also, it has the fourth fastest internet in the world. These come from Numbeo and, I think, a study made by Bloomberg. And there, of course, is Latvia on the map, which you unfortunately can't see very well. I'm sorry, but you'll have to imagine rest of Europe around that little around that little red patch over there. But like Burton already helpfully pointed out, the location on the map, we already know that. The talent pool is a challenge in a small country. Latvia has good universities. The two big ones are the Riga Technical University and the University of Latvia, which have that 35,000 students more or less combined. The remaining schools, I think University of Latvia is around 20,000, Riga Technical around 15,000, and the other schools from there are considerably smaller. We have quite a few co-working spaces have been popping up lately. I'll mention two of them. The first one is Tech Hub, who started out of London, right next to the Silicon Roundabout area in Shoreditch, and opened their first satellite office in Riga, which definitely put Latvia on the tech map in Europe. The Mill is a small, independent co-working space, which is beautifully located in the city center in a building where Richard Wagner used to compose some of his best work. Very inspiring. Some of the support network is provided by the government. The LIA is the Latvian Investment and Development Agency. Altum is a governmental body providing loans subsidized loans of under 100K, more or less. And the Cup of Ideas, Idea y Caos, is a business contest rewarding, I think, around 15,000 euros total every year. There's a bit of disappointment from the startups in Latvia that I have spoken with about the level of support that they can get over there. I have spoken with a couple who have either moved to Berlin or to London, or who have just moved the company to Finland, out of all places, but kept people working in Riga. But they have actually founded a Finnish company instead, because they have found that the ecosystem and the level of support instruments is much more developed there. But there are some interesting tech companies in Latvia, definitely. Ask.fm was recently acquired by Ask.com after some... this was a B2C company, definitely. I was actually making a note of Matej's point about B2B versus B2C companies with interest, and comparing this to my list quickly here. Ask.fm was an anonymous Q&A platform which had some cyberbullying problems. And was later acquired by Ask.com. AirDog is a really cool drone, basically, that follows you around, that raised about $1.5 million in Kickstarter. Front is a B2D, business-to-designer product for responsive site design. Selfie for digital product sales. And then a couple of more interesting, or kind of not tech startup-y ones. MikroTik. Is a router and wireless interface system provider and maker in Latvia. They've been creating their own hardware since last 12 years. And Forticom is something that you don't usually hear mentioned, but that's an example of the strong Eastern influence and ties. They are in the social networking business through Odnoklasniki, and are part of the MailRU or Digital Sky Technologies group. And of course, there's Infogram. So I'll give you a couple of thoughts about Riga and about Latvia in general. I was surprised how international Riga was as a city. I had visited there a few times before joining Infogram full-time, and now have... You know, I'm happy to consider that a second home, and especially coming from Finland, it was really surprising to see how well Latvia was connected both east and west. Because traditionally, when I was growing up, and even in my later formative years, the border between Finland and Russia was really strongly closed. There was trade, of course, but there was not really cultural exchange or movement and so forth. Whereas Latvia, having been a part of that bloc that remained very much Eastern focused for almost a century, still has very strong connections, not only to Russia but also former Soviet countries. So it's been wonderful to kind of get that new level of connections that I didn't think that we could benefit from as much as we have. And at the same time, it's a very Western-looking country, a Euro country, a NATO country, and has strong ties all the way across the Atlantic. And Latvia, like many other small countries, have been wondering about their competitiveness and how they should how they can find their fertile soil for growing new businesses, let's put it that way. And I've had the opportunity of being a part of these kinds of innovation initiatives, kicked off a large study of an innovation ecosystem in Finland, sat in the Silicon Roundabout area and helped Silicon Valley Comes to UK program, for instance, over there in the UK. And like I said, with Google, helped kick off some emerging markets. And so I've been following this with pretty keen interest on what they want to do there. And too often the model seems to be one where we want to learn from Silicon Valley. We want to create this tech-friendly, you know, really innovative ecosystem. And that hasn't seemed to work many times, right? I mean, Berlin has been up and coming as a tech ecosystem for a few years now. There's lots of good startups from Berlin. I'm not saying that. London, the same thing. The Silicon Roundabout area is producing interesting startups. But whether there's measurable development in that direction, I'm not sure. And I'm not sure if that actually should be the focus, especially for a very small country. Because if you're able to create that kind of a system, subsidize a system, for instance, where tech startups are easy to start, they also move abroad very easily. They can be bought out and they move to the US. That's happened in Latvia at least once. I mean, that's one of the reasons why I think Google and Facebook are sponsoring startup like Google Campus, for instance, in London. Whereas there's for a country like Latvia, there's an example much closer to home that would be interesting. And I think that's Dublin. And Dublin has been able to position itself as a hub of international business. Not so much as a tech hub, but instead a sales and customer service and remote service hub. And that's something that these countries should take into account. And this is something that I'm talking about with some of my potential colleagues and co-conspirators over in Latvia about, where instead of focusing on the traditional export model, where you have a factory in the homeland, and then you invest in sending salespeople abroad, and then they make sales, and export happens, right? We should be embracing the new model of export, where we, like us in the case of Infogram, are literally doing every day, we're able to produce, sell, and service from this one central hub. And instead of sending these people abroad, we are able to bring the best talent from abroad to this one hub and grow that hub over that kind of expertise. Of course, it still needs the technological expertise. It's sort of easy for us to say now. We already have a functioning product with millions of users. But nonetheless, that is this new model of export. And in Latvia's case, that would be like a triple whammy, because it is. Export, it is money coming into the country, it is getting international talent into the country, and it's also making the country more appealing to the Latvians who either are in the country or who have actually left after Latvia, for example, joined the EU. So there's been a big political debate about the reversing the brain drain and about how Latvia could get back the bright young talent who moved to work in London and Berlin in the last decade, for instance. So those were my quick observations about that topic. But I'm, like I said, I am certainly happy to keep discussing this. Thank you.
Thank you.
Question?
Yes.
So if you look at the statistics of undergraduate majors in the US, the most popular ones tend to be business and psychology. Do you know, or can you guess, which majors are most popular in Latvia?
I did look at that. But I may not have it off the top of my head. I think engineering is surprisingly popular. So, like, if you compare, if the two biggest universities are University of Latvia, 20,000, all majors, Riga Technical University, 15,000, primarily engineering. That gives you something. I think engineering is much higher represented in terms of weights.
Aylor.
Yeah, I want to follow up on your last point that you made about creating a hub to bring talent in and so on to Latvia. And I'm curious about the impact of your neighbor. You know, you're right next to Estonia, and Estonia has been getting a lot of attention in the valley. And I'm very intrigued by their e-residency program. And
right.
Here they're going to bring in 10 million people from around the world, and they have fantastic infrastructure and all this stuff happening. And you are right next door to them. So is there competition, you know, Italian versus Riga? Is it collaboration? And Estonia is collaborating a lot with Finland, right next door to Finland. What is that What is that dynamic of Latvia versus Estonia and Finland?
Yeah, I think there's this. I think there's this benign competition going on, definitely all the time. Many intriguing points there. Latvia certainly benchmarks itself against Estonia quite a bit. If I'd get a dollar for every time I've heard we need a Latvian Skype, you know, that would make for a nice seed investment. The Skype, of course, you know, having strong bases in Estonia. Then, you know, from a perspective of somebody from Finland, you know, we keep talking about we need a new Nokia, and so I'm sort of listening to that. You know, we need a Latvian Skype as something as, you know, this too shall pass. But yes, the country needs success stories like that. I think that's a key point about there being a need for Latvian Skype. How Latvia could compete with Estonia? I think there's a lot Latvia can learn. I don't think it's certainly not a zero sum game. There's a lot of cooperation going on there. But if Estonia's e-residency program, for example, works out, a small country like Latvia could be fast to move there as well. But that's certainly something I have not looked into.
Are they looking at doing?
I certainly haven't looked into that. I haven't heard of that. Yeah.
I'm sure it's gotten a lot of notice in the Latvian government.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Kind of behind the scenes. Let's see. I think we had a question in the back here. Tech Hub.
Yeah.
Let's go back quickly to your Tech Hub slide. So last week, two sessions ago, we had Mike Butcher.
Yes.
Here, who's the co-founder of Tech Hub. Let's see, where is Tech Hub?
It was
co-founder of Tech Hub London. Sorry.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But just little.
Yeah, I sat next to Mike, or close to Mike in London for a while.
Little footnote, the founder, one of the co-founders of Tech Hub Riga is a Stanford Graduate School of Business guy, Andrus Berzins.
Also an Infogram advisor.
Infogram advisor.
Yes.
Excellent. Hack Forward, which is not well known here in the Valley, was created by Lars Hinrichs, who was founder, co-founder of Zing, which was the early German language only social network, which was sold many years ago, one of the early successful exits in Europe. So just to draw a little bit of a picture of the web here. I spent some time last year at Riga Technical University as a visiting professor. So I got to spend a week plus inside the university talking with students, faculty. What level of engagement do you see with Latvian students around entrepreneurship? How much interest do you get from them about joining Infogram? You know, are you inundated with applications from students from the Latvian technical universities, business schools, who really want to work at Infogram as kind of the Facebook of Latvia, the best place? Or are they still applying mostly to corporates, to banks, to consulting companies as the preferred jobs today?
We do have a lot of interest from graduates of these schools, especially RTU. We could have more, so it's not. I don't think it's as strongly on the map as it should be. I mean, Infogram is a pretty big fish in a pretty small pond when it comes to startups in Latvia at the moment. So I think in proportion, I would like to see more applicants, for instance, and we're actually doing more on that recruiting scene. But I think that was like one of the complaints. So when I was talking to startups, and I did some research for this, spoke to guys from Front and Selfie and Faster, for instance. I think the lack of university involvement in the startup ecosystem is a source of disappointment. I heard an anecdote of how somebody high up in the university ecosystem is not particularly supportive of students starting tech companies, for instance, but instead applying to work at these more established companies.
Okay. Mate, can we bring you up now? Because this issue of university student engagement is really important, and can we scrunch you guys together so you're on the same screen? Coming back to Lean Launchpad, here we find Lean Launchpad developed out of Stanford Engineering School by Steve Blank initially, not being taught at a Slovakian university by a Slovakian engineering or business professor, but by a Slovakian accelerator. What's your take on the level of engagement between Slovakian universities and the startup community and generally around entrepreneurship, just to contrast with Latvia?
Sure. In terms of engineering qualities, as I mentioned, these universities are very involved, and startups have their presence in the university, and the students know about the startups and are able to be part of the force there. But in terms of the business, business schools and the business environment, still I think more education is needed to be done there in terms of bringing good talent and actually finding the good talent in Slovakia to be able to work for startups or actually starting their own companies. Because the education that they're being taught right now in the business schools are more how to manage an existing corporation, how to run a business unit, and not how to create a wildly new idea that is going to disrupt the world and is, you know, running against the odds. That's the difference. Mm.
Sorry. Would you expect that any faculty at business schools or engineering schools in Slovakia today would even know what Lean Launchpad is?
As we've been talking to a few of them, I know that a few of them know about it because we introduced it to them. There is a couple of very bright professors on those universities that we're talking to, and we're hoping that we're going to create, you know, joint projects together in terms of bringing this kind of lectures or courses to the university.
Mm-hmm. Miko. And Matej talked about the engagement of corporates, you know, how important corporates are on the Slovakian, you know, industrial scene, and that the corporate and startup sector, accelerator sector, is beginning to collaborate, work, find ways to engage corporates. What's your perception of what's happening with the corporates in Latvia? It's obviously a smaller ecosystem,
sure.
Much more limited. I'm guessing the corporates there are primarily banking, is there much manufacturing going on in Latvia today?
I think it's more banking, but in terms of the tech ecosystem, the telcos and Lattel, for example, TV Next. From the telco and media industry, there's certainly involvement in there. I think Delphi, for instance, a large publisher locally and regionally, rather, is quite active in supporting, for example, some of the startup contests.
Okay. But has Latvia had a strong manufacturing sector historically? My impression is that they've never had one at the level of Slovakia, for example,
no.
or other.
No, I think it's more been about logistics,
and
especially
services,
which has then
logistics.
gone into financing sector.
Ken, question.
Yeah, so for me, with respect to Latvia,
can you move away from the light? We can't see you.
So the last time I was in Riga, I made a snowbobusko about this time of year.
Okay.
So my question actually is, why isn't SSE Riga on your chart?
SSE Riga is a great school.
SSE is the Stockholm School of Economics.
Yeah.
It's one of the leading business schools in Scandinavia.
And they received a very large gift from a very wealthy American.
And they have branches, I believe, in Tallinn, in Riga. I don't know if they're in Vilnius or not. But they're very well-regarded business school in the Baltic region.
Yeah, and we do have some graduates from the SSE, certainly. Okay, very good, very good. Because it's in terms of talking about the talent pool, it's a pretty small player. I wanted to more illustrate the size of the talent pool in this case. I think SSE is 700 students tops, something like that. Very highly regarded. I think 25th in European business schools.
For both of you. What is your response to the Netherlands claiming that they're the center of innovation for Europe? It's a recent claim.
You first.
well, thank you. Appreciate it.
Can you repeat the question, please, Ken?
Netherlands has recently stated that they are the center of innovation for all of Europe. They go ahead and chart out a unicorn that they got going, and they say they have more networking, better technical skill than anybody else in Europe.
Okay, I'll take that first. I think per capita they could be, right? I mean, it's a relatively small country with you know, a great international network. Anecdotally, I have always found doing business in the Netherlands to be very easy. They're very quick to adapt, try out new things, and so forth, which I'm sure feeds very well into innovation. So I actually have nothing against that claim.
And for myself, I've been to the Eindhoven research centers and the labs and the universities right there in Eindhoven. It was a very impressive location and campus with a lot of research centers there, and I've seen a lot of good stuff coming out from that part. Also, Amsterdam is a very vibrant startup city, so if they claim that, good for them, but I cannot say if they are the best or not, but yeah, they can claim that. We can claim we have the flying car, so you know.
Lars.
I found the idea very interesting that you mentioned, Nico, that the Baltics could be a bridge eastwards towards Russia. Especially in light of recent events, we've been very critical of the Soviet ecosystem in Russia. But I'd be very interested to hear from both of you, you especially, Nico, because you mentioned it was beneficial to you, some of the, let's say, more optimistic stories about collaboration with Russian startups, with the Russian market.
Right. I don't think we're not at the point where I could talk about collaboration with Russian startups. However, so Latvia is interesting demographic wise. I think demographics are very comparable to Ukraine in the number of like native Russian speakers, for instance. I think it's 27 or 29% in both countries. The trade connections and financial connections to Russia are very strong, and looking at it on a not, you know, the macro national level, I think there are lots of opportunities and some challenges from the macro situation. Yes. But I'd rather think that as scrappy innovative startups, I'm sure we can put any problems like that aside and work you know, as we see fit.
We see in Slovakia as having Ukraine as a border country. In the last several months, with all the development in the Ukraine, there has been a surge of CVs of very talented Ukrainian developers have been asking for work in Slovakia with, you know, ASAP work, basically. So that's,
yeah,
that's
we actually, yeah. Yeah, saw that as well.
So this brings us back to our first session, January 5th, Startups and War, the Impact of War on Entrepreneurship Ecosystems. So here we see a tangible effect of conflict in eastern Ukraine actually driving entrepreneurs, but also developers, out of the country into neighboring countries, which is great for Slovakia, but not great for Ukraine, obviously.
Yeah.
And who knows what the impact in Latvia might be if things heat up along the Latvia-Russia borders as well. We just don't know at this point.
Sure.
Any final questions? Yes, sir.
Generally speaking, when you think of startups or tech ecosystems, you think of Silicon Valley. Are you guys seeing that need of startups that are
Well, representing a startup that has come to Silicon Valley, there's certainly I could sympathize with the graph you made in terms of what is available in the country very much. So, for instance, hiring talent who has experience with a B2B SaaS business model product is very difficult over there. So, for example, finding a product marketing manager who has worked with similar kinds of challenges, we've come here to find that person, for instance. I mean, we have that person in the team now here. So that same person could be found in, you know, Berlin, London, Warsaw, for that matter. It's not absolutely necessary. I think in our case, it was a kind of an opportunistic move. I was here already, so, you know, we decided to start working in building our first international office over here. And there are, you know, of course, there are benefits of being present in Silicon Valley.
if I may point to the position of Slovakia or the Slovak startups, a lot of them are really early stage, and it's kind of easy in a small market like Slovakia to get easily noticed and to get a lot of media press and attention from the local bloggers and from the local magazines. Startups are cool, and they can get ahead of themselves in terms of, oh, we already made it. And it's very healthy for them and good for them to come to the valley and to get the punch into the face to understand that, dude, it's like you're not there by far. So it's a wake-up call for a lot of the startups that have a 10-day, 2-week, or a month trip here to the valley to understand that the world is much bigger than Bratislava and Košice.
So could we please give our speakers a hand? Matej? So,
oh, great. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
You came all the way from Bratislava. We really appreciate your effort and your support for our program. Miko?
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Next week, session 7, Estonia, Berlin, Barcelona, big data startups and co-working spaces. Please join us. And then March 9, our final session is Romania and Bulgaria. Thank you very much. Feel free to please come up and network and meet the speakers.